The world is a bundle of complex histories and characteristics. And sometimes, to really understand someone or something, you have to capture all of that complexity as a bundle. Which is another way of talking about the fact that everyone and everything can be described via sets of characteristics. So, if you're trying to discover the profile of your respondents with respect to a certain set of characteristics, or you're trying to figure out how different sets of characteristics might correlate with different segments of respondents, you need a multi-select checkbox question. If you've ever come across a survey question that lets you check all that apply or choose your top three, you're already familiar with the multi-select checkbox. This question type basically groups together a related set of yes-no style questions under a single master question. Each checkbox option represents one of the yes-no questions that basically asks, with respect to the master question, is this characteristic true? For each option, a checked checkbox indicates a yes, and an unchecked checkbox indicates a no. The multi-select checkbox question is typically considered a closed-ended question. Closed-ended means that you supply a list of options to choose from, and the number of different answers you might get back is limited by the range of options you've supplied. But what about options that aren't on your radar? And what about respondents feeling like the survey wasn't for them because, as far as they're concerned, none of the options apply? You can address both of these concerns by adding the option of other, please specify, to the end of your list of options. That other option is open-ended, meaning respondents can fill in the blank with whatever option they think you missed, and you might get a different answer from every single respondent. If you're not sure that the question will apply to all of your respondents, be sure to add a closed-ended option for not applicable. What about the response rates for surveys with multi-select checkbox questions? Easy-to-answer questions and the perception of there only being a small number of questions to answer often translate to higher response rates. Checkboxes are easy to check and uncheck, so they can be easy to answer. And by condensing multiple yes-no questions into a single question, with only a handful of options, you create a perception of there being less to answer. There are a couple of factors that will determine the informational success of your multi-select checkbox question: the degree to which your question options are logically grouped and logically disparate, and the formatting of the question and options. The logically grouped and logically disparate criteria might sound like they're at odds, but really, they address complementary issues. Logically grouped ties back to the fact that you should only ever ask one question at a time so that your respondents are really clear about what information you want from them. You can foster this by making sure that all of your checkbox options fall into a single category. Are they all going to be behaviors, like what respondents do in their free time? Preferences, like the topics your respondents would like you to address in a podcast or speaker series? Perceptions, like the types of marketing your respondents think they need to sustain or grow their businesses? Priorities, like where your respondents want to focus their efforts? Or maybe some other single category. You also need your checkbox options to be logically disparate within that logical group. You want a good range of options to help you cover your bases, but you don't want the options to overlap because that can make it hard for your respondents to figure out which options they're supposed to select. As an example, imagine you're asking about a company's priorities, and you've offered options for upgrading your existing facility and updating your existing facility. You might know that in one case you mean buying new equipment, and in the other case, cosmetic changes like reupholstering benches. But then, are new lighting fixtures new equipment or cosmetic? Most people aren't even making this distinction, so your options don't need to either. So how might formatting affect the success of your question? First, if your survey application lets you display options vertically or horizontally, choose to display vertically, so you get one option per line. That makes it more likely that the answers chosen are the answers your respondents wanted to check, instead of accidentally choosing the checkbox on the wrong side of the option. Second, keep the list as short as possible. That usually means a maximum list length of 6. You want to make sure that your respondents stay focused on the question they're answering, and the easiest way to do that is to make sure that the question and the options can be viewed together. Many survey tools will let you preview what your survey will look like on the standard computer screen, as well as on a mobile device, and you want to check both. Finally, if your options are written as sentences, word the options in a positive way, like, I endorse, I support, I agree, because positive statements are easier to read and evaluate. And try to avoid commas in your sentences, because commas can make analyzing the data trickier. The data that you get from a multi-select checkbox might take a few different forms, which is dependent on which survey tool you're using to collect that data. Regardless of your tool, chances are good that you'll need to do some data transformation, meaning that you're going to change some of the values or add some new columns of data beyond what was collected by the survey tool, so be sure to work from a copy of the data and not the original data set. Let's say that your survey question number 5 is a multi-select checkbox question with 3 closed-ended options and 1 open-ended option for other. Every survey tool will separate the closed-ended options from the open-ended other option. You'll review and analyze the other data on its own and decide whether it warrants being incorporated into your analysis in its own right, because respondents basically provided a new checkbox option to consider, or whether you just want to treat it like a closed-ended check for an option called other. Aside from that, there are 3 main variations for how the closed-ended option data might appear in spreadsheet view. The first variation of the resulting dataset will list the question 5 option text as the column headers, with each subsequent row representing a single respondent's response to the survey. Checked checkboxes will be indicated by the digit 1 in the cell for that option. Unchecked checkboxes will either be blank or filled with a 0. That means that all you need to do is add the numbers to figure out how many respondents selected that option, which is how you can find out the most and least popular options selected. The second variation also lists the question 5 option text as the column headers, but now checked checkboxes will be indicated by the full option text. To tally this, you'll need to count filled or non-blank cells for each option column. Depending on the type of analysis you want to do, you might need to replace those text strings with digits, meaning a 1 wherever there was a checked option. The third variation is the most complex, and it's the reason why it's important to not include commas in the text of your options. The column header for the question will now just be something like question 5, or the text of the question itself. Responses to the question will be represented as a comma-delimited list of the option text selected. If you want to tally responses by option, or filter the rest of the dataset by a particular option, you'll first need to post-process those comma-delimited lists into another format, like one column per option. Because the list is comma-delimited, you'll look for commas as the indicator of where to split up the option selections, which is why you don't want to use commas in your option text. Doing so makes it harder to figure out if it's a comma in your option text or a comma that's a delimiter, and that can make this splitting up process harder to automate. To find correlations between this data and other responses in the dataset, you'll start by looking for the relationships between the individual options selected for this question and other question responses. No one is just one thing, including your respondents. So how will you use multi-select checkbox questions to learn more about the bundles of characteristics that make your respondents who they are today? If you learned something from this video, don't forget to like, comment, subscribe, and share it with someone who needs it. If you still got questions about multi-select checkbox questions, or surveys in general, that's okay, because the videos in this sequence are for general information purposes. Drop your question below, or reach out to me, Barbara Olsavsky, the owner and data wrangler at Blou Designs LLC, on Calendly or LinkedIn. Thank you for watching!